Good morning. Yeah, there we are. Good morning, Hebron. How are you doing this morning? I wanted to welcome you this morning. You see some people on stage and some people out in the audience with these shirts on. Sorry, I'm up trying not to get emotional. These are for my son. These are for Connor Jubin. I just want to thank everybody. Wait, let me start. So for those of you who don't know, my son had an accident on June the 3rd. Thursday, it was 100 days, so it's been 103 days since his accident. He was biking. He fell from his bike. He's a cyclist, thousands of miles every year. And whenever he had his accident, he was immediately rushed to the hospital. He was diagnosed with traumatic brain injury. He had to have surgery. And after the surgery, he was unresponsive for 28 days. And after he became responsive, his eyes opened. He was able to process things. And then for basically another month after that, we tried to get Connor to a specialty hospital. And then from the specialty hospital, he had to have another surgery. And he has other things going on. But I just want to thank you guys for everything, for the support, for, you know, the wearing the shirts. A lot of people have given money. This is a condition where it's not months till he gets better. It's years. And we don't know what's going to happen to Connor. We don't know what it's going to be like whenever, you know, whenever he's done with his therapy and whenever everything's done. We honestly pray that we'll get all of Connor back and that he'll be able to live a life that that he wants to live. But, you know, I've learned a lot. My family's learned a lot through this time. And, you know, you can say a lot of things. A lot of people could get mad. They could get angry. But I've just really learned, you know, God has a plan and God is good. And I want to, again, thank you, everyone. If you said a prayer, if you bought a shirt or anything, it's been tremendously important to my family, and it's been tremendously important to him, even though he doesn't yet understand a lot of things that's going on. He's not there. He's not walking. He's not able to do a lot of things physically, and again, that's just going to take time. But, you know, it's just good to be in a house and in a family like Hebron where you know that there are people who are watching out for you.
Let's pray for Rusty and Connor and his family. Heavenly Father, Lord, just saying your name, Father, we know you, Lord, know what it's like to watch your son suffer and when he suffered for us. And God, but we also know that you're a healer. God, we do pray for healing in Connor's life. We thank you for what you have allowed to happen so far. God, as I hear that beep every so often, it makes me think, how many times have the machines beeped around Connor, Lord, and just how, God, he's had so much done to him in such a short period of time, God. Lord, it must be so painful for this family to walk this road that you have them on right now. God, I pray that you would encourage them, that you would uplift Rusty, Lord, in the times when the darkness comes, and God, that you would give him hope. Lord, we know that you can bring all things to a good place. And God, we pray that you would continue to work good in Connor's life and that you would bring more and more healing, Lord. And I pray through this, Lord, people would come to know about you. God, help help our family be an encouragement to this family. Lord, I thank you that you've given us church to be together with, Lord, and to walk through life. And Lord, I just pray that you would help us to love like you, God, in a better way. God, thank you for Rusty and the encouragement he is to other people, Lord. And I just pray that you would uplift him in this time and that you would just work in Connor's body, Lord. Lord, we love you. And it's the name of Christ we pray and ask for these things. Amen.
Thank you, Rusty.
Y'all stand up. Y'all come in. Come and worship with us today. Let's praise God this morning.
Thank you. If you're a guest today, there's a program at the end of the rows, and we hope that all of you get a program. In it is a lot of stuff today. I mean, we could go for hours unpacking this thing. But inside is a connection card, and we'd encourage all of you, if you would, to take out that connection card, fill it out, and as you're exiting, there's a box on both exits out front here at the round table and over here on the side. And if you would, just put that connection card in there as you're leaving. It always is a blessing to me to know that you are with us today. So if you're a regular attender or a guest, please fill that out. On the back is a place where you can actually share a prayer request. And then we encourage you to make a commitment to meditate on the verse of the week. And there's a verse card there in your program that you can carry around with you all week. And maybe today, for the first time, you need to begin a relationship with Jesus Christ. And so if you make that decision with God today, we'd encourage you to let us know about it. And then also, there's a place to recommit your life to Christ. And maybe you want to follow the Lord in believer's baptism. Or maybe today you want to commit to pray for one person. And we're going to be encouraging you. In there is a Who's Your One? It's a card that we'd encourage you this week to think about and pray about, God laying on your heart, one person that you could invest and invite. And we encourage you all to invite someone next Sunday. We're going to have a back-to-church Sunday, bring a friend. And so we're encouraging all to do that. After the service, we're going to have a meal. And so hopefully you can bring a friend and come join us and introduce me to your one. And then also this week is a little prayer guide for the Georgia Barnett annual offering for state missions. So all the money that is collected for Georgia Barnett goes to help share the gospel here in our state. And so we'd encourage you to do that. You've already heard from Brother Rusty Jubin this morning. And the Caring Bridge is place where you can go and donate money if you'd like to help the family and help them out some also. And then also kids time. Some of you are reading that right after I get through here, you're to let your children go. We're going to move that back and let them stay in the worship service until we sing and do all the worship singing. And when I come up to speak, then they can go to their kids time. And then also, this afternoon, we have a deacon's meeting, and if you're interested, we're going to be starting a new handbell choir, and we'd love to have you participate if you'd like to do that. Also, all of you that'd like to come on Tuesday at 6 p.m., we're having our church council meeting this week, and then the youth are going to have a leadership impact retreat at the end of this week, and then also be in prayer for our weather. This week we have another storm barreling in on us, and pray that it will somehow dissipate and that it won't come in as full force hurricane and devastate those in New Orleans and throughout our state as the last one did. But we want all of you to feel welcome. Normally, under unusual normal circumstances, I would be out there greeting you. But because of COVID, we can't do that. So let's greet each other. I'm going to come over here. Some of you are new, and you've come in, and you're going, what is the deal with this church? I don't see hardly anybody wearing masks. In this section from here over, you can wear masks or not wear masks. But we have a section over here reserved for those at high risk, and they wear masks. If you'd like to be a part of that group, feel welcome to join them. But please don't break the physical distance with them, okay? Respect them. They're coming back. We're so glad you're here. I got to preach to this section and all these sections with just empty chairs just a few months ago. So it's great to see people coming back. And we're glad that y'all are being so cooperative. And thank y'all for coming. And so let's greet one another. We're going to give each other a hug today. Okay, and this group, we're going to fist bump. Yeah, even you guests, yeah, we're fist bumping with you. And this group over here, we're blowing kisses. And this group over here, what else can we do? Let's give a high five. How about a high five? There we go. High five and everybody over here. We're glad that you're here worshiping with us today. And we look forward to worship. Hopefully you'll come again. If you're not a part of church family, at the end of the month, on the 27th, we have an exploring membership class. If you'd like to come and attend, it doesn't make you a member, but it does allow you to catch a glimpse of our vision and direction. And we hope that you'll come join us and be a part, but enjoy worshiping with us this morning. I'm going to ask Mrs. Peyton if she would come read our scripture for the day, and then we'll continue worshiping the Lord in song.
James 5, 12 through 18 says, "But most of all, my brothers and sisters, never take an oath by heaven or earth or anything else. Just say a simple yes or no so that you will not sin and be condemned. Are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. Are any of you sick? You should call for the elders of the church to come and pray over you, anointing you with an oil, the name of the Lord. Such a prayer offered in faith will heal the sick, and the Lord will make you well. And if you have committed any sins, you will be forgiven. Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. Elijah was a human as we are, and yet when he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, none fell for 3.5 years. Then when he prayed again, the sky went down, sent down rain, and the earth began to yield its crops."
Now stand up, let's raise a hallelujah.
Louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. everything that I could box you in. But I'm laying down, I wanna know you, Lord. I used to think that I could box you in, but I'm laying down, I wanna know you, Lord. I'm laying down all my religion, out, and I reach out and you find me in the dust, and you say no amount of untruths can separate us. In the simple gospel, I will rejoice in you, Lord. I will rejoice in the simple gospel.
Thank you for this worship today. God, just thank you for everybody here who's made it, everybody who's braving the COVID, braving the storm, Lord. Just please just be with us all, comfort us here, Lord. Please be with Brother Charlie as he leads us through sermon, Lord. We love you. Amen.
I believe there is no doubt, 'cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire, do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. What you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life, and do what you are famous for. I believe in you. Release your love inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over. Make way through. Walk me through the fire, do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think, Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable. All things are possible in you. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think. Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable.
If you have your Bibles, I'd encourage you to go ahead and open them to James chapter 5 as we continue in our series. There's probably not a man on earth more qualified to speak to us on prayer than James, the author of this book. And you may say, well, why is that? Well, the reason is, according to church tradition and history, he had a nickname. You want to know what his nickname was? Old Camel Knees. That was his nickname. And it wasn't because he was old, But it was because he had calluses on his knees because of spending so much time in prayer. Now, this isn't the first time that James introduces us to prayer in his book. In chapter 1, James said, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God. And so right off from the get-go in James chapter 1, he introduces us to prayer. And then again in chapter 4, verse 2, he said, you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And he goes on to say in verse 3 of chapter 4, and even when you ask, you don't get what you're, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. So we talked about praying with the right motives so that God's will is done. Now here at the conclusion, he introduces us again to prayer. And in six verses, he mentions seven times the word prayer. And some of you may go, well, you know, I'm not sure I can relate to old camel knees. My knees are not calloused because of my prayer. To be honest with you, it's probably one of the most challenging disciplines for Christ followers to spend consistent time with the Lord in prayer. Maybe you identify more with Peter. Jesus addressing Peter and James and John in the Garden of Gethsemane in Matthew 26, he said, keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. And then Jesus went further on into the garden and he prayed some more. And when he came back, what did he find the disciples doing? Sleeping, that's right. They had drifted off to sleep. I think they had the spiritual gift of sleeping. And Jesus had to wake them up. And again, he says in chapter 26, verse 40 and following, couldn't you watch with me even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you do not give in to temptation, for the spirit is willing, but the body is not. Now, remember James, last time we met, we talked about verses 7 through 11, and James shared with us that the primary idea of that passage was we need to be patient till Jesus comes. And today, in verses 12 through 18, the main idea of this passage is we need to be prayerful until the Lord returns. Someone said, like a car without fuel, life without prayer grinds to a halt. It's kind of like our car running out of gas. It just doesn't go anywhere anymore. And if we don't have prayer in our spiritual lives, we kind of stall out. So James is calling us to pray in this passage. And he gives us four different circumstances of life where we should spend time in prayer specifically. And the first one, he says, God wants us to pray when we're suffering. Now, if you have a program and your program is a listening guide, if you're taking notes, you might want to write that down. God wants us to pray when we're suffering. And in verse 12, it says this in James 5. But most of all, my brothers and sisters, never take an oath by heaven or earth or anything else. Just say a simple yes or no so that you will not sin and be condemned. Now, he's talking here about swearing by God. And we've probably all heard people swear, I swear by God, they say. But he's saying, let your yes be yes. In other words, be a man or a woman of your word. And let your no be no, so that you do not sin and then are condemned. Now, what does James mean by, brothers and sisters, never take an oath? Some renderings of this in different translations use for the word oath, swear. And so, what that is talking about is not primarily coarse language or profanity. The Bible is very clear that if you're a Christ follower, that should have absolutely no part of your vocabulary. It makes it clear in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29, where it says, don't use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. So what happens when we suffer? What happens when we feel like people really don't believe us? Well, sometimes people lean towards swearing and swearing oaths. And they say things, they use language that you would never use in a building like this. And so the primary thing that he's saying here is he's forbidding the swearing of oaths, not necessarily the using of foul language. That's addressed in other places. Now, it doesn't mean when you're in a courtroom and they ask you to witness and testify and they ask you to swear on the Bible and take an oath and you say, I do solemnly swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help me God. And you say, I do. It's not referring to that. But isn't that so hypocritical? I mean, we see people do that and they don't even believe in God. They don't believe that the Bible is the Word of God, and yet they're swearing on the Bible. And why is that? Well, the reason is because we're such liars. We're such liars that we have to swear in order to tell the truth. We've probably all heard people that say, well, let me be truthful with you. As if everything they've said before wasn't truthful. Now I'm going to tell you the truth. Or people that say, I swear by God. Like if when you didn't swear by God, nothing you said was truthful. Folks, we need to be people of the Word. Basically, what James is actually saying here is let your speech be with reverence and truthful. So, in other words, when you're suffering and hurting, don't swear oaths. Don't curse, but turn to God in prayer. Now, look at verse 13. He says, are any of you suffering hardship? You should pray. And the word suffering there means any kind of trouble, any kind of misfortune, any kind of hard time or difficult experience that you're going through. And in the book of Job, in Job chapter 5, it says, people are born for trouble as readily as sparks fly up from the fire. And if you've ever been around a bonfire, you see sparks constantly flying up. And we have difficulties and troubles. Have you noticed that life is full of sorrow? It's full of hurts, full of troubles, full of difficulties. I love that old spiritual song, nobody knows the trouble I've seen. And sometimes that could be your song. You come here and you smile and you act like everything's just hunky-dory. But you know the troubles that you have that are going on in your own personal life. And a lot of times we have personal challenges, and we all have those. I heard about a gentleman who was on his deathbed, and he'd been laying there for a couple of months in and out of a coma, and his wife had faithfully been by his side. And finally, when he realized he was about ready to pass on, he motioned her to come closer, and he said, honey, you were with me. And you stood by my side when they almost fired me. And you were there. And you stood by my side when we lost our business. And you didn't go anywhere, but you were right there faithfully with me when our house burned down. And he said, when I got shot, you nursed me back to health. And he said, honey, he said, even when my health has taken a turn for the worse, you've been here faithfully every moment. And then he motioned for her to get closer. He said, honey, I think you're just bad luck. Folks, we all go through hard times. And sometimes as Christ followers, we think we're above hard times. But as Christ followers, we get sick, we have trouble, we suffer loss, we have fender benders, get cancer, we hurt. And folks, we suffer just like everyone else. And even as Christ followers, sometimes we suffer more because the unbelieving world sometimes puts us down for our faith and our values. Sometimes they ostracize us. Jesus said, they did it to me and they will do it to you. So the word suffering there means any kind of trouble. And maybe this morning, maybe you're here and you're going through some very challenging times. Maybe it's a downtime emotionally for you. Maybe you're having marital problems. Maybe there's some sad times. Maybe your children are causing pain and hardship in your life. Or maybe you have great debt and you're unable to pay it. And so you're experiencing the stress. Or maybe you've lost a job. Or maybe your salary's been slashed and you're having a hard time. Or maybe in your home, you're having a hard time with your family. Or maybe your job. Whatever the challenge you're facing, James says, pray. And that's right in line with Scripture. In Philippians chapter 4, verse 6, it says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He's done. You see, if you do this, the peace of God will guard your mind and your heart. This is really a prescription here for peace. And the Scriptures are encouraging us not to worry, but to pray. Kind of like the example in 1 Kings. In 1 Kings, there was King Hezekiah, the king of Israel. And he was opposed by Sennacherib, the wicked king of Syria. And this wicked king wrote King Hezekiah a blasphemous letter. And in the letter he said, your God isn't going to protect you. Your God isn't going to take care of you. Don't think that your God is going to be there for you. I'm going to attack you and I'm going to destroy you. And he sent him this letter. And when Hezekiah received the letter, he took that letter and he walked into the temple. And at the time, Isaiah was the prophet. And he walked into the temple and he went to the temple altar. And he took that letter and he walked up to the temple altar and he set it down on the temple altar. And he said, God, have you seen that letter? Hezekiah was challenging God. He said, Sennacherib sent me this letter. Have you read it? He says that we can't trust you. He says that you're not going to take care of us. I'm here just to remind you that we're your people. And God, you promised to watch over and take care of us. So God, you have a big problem. And if you haven't seen it, it's there. And he just left it on the altar and he left. He took off. He left God that letter. And folks, that's a beautiful picture of what the Scriptures tell us to do. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, it says, give all your worries and cares to God, for He cares for you. God actually cares about your hurts, about your pains, about your sorrows, your fears, and your struggles. God cares so much that He wants us to cast our cares upon Him. He wants to carry all of our problems and all of our load. The psalmist said it like this in Psalm 25. He said, leave your troubles with the Lord, and He will defend you. He will never let the honest or the just people be defeated. So the first category where James encourages us to pray is really the simplest. Anytime we're hurting or suffering, we have no problem crying out. And during those times, God wants us to cry out to Him and say, God, I need help. And God is there to help us. But then He gives us a second category of circumstances in which we need to pray. And He says, God wants us to pray when we're happy. Notice at the end of verse 13 what it says. It says, are any of you happy? You should sing praises. You see, when we're suffering, we have no problem crying out to God and praying. But sometimes, when everything's going good, we kind of have a tendency to forget God. And folks, the Christian life isn't always doom and gloom and sorrow. As we follow God, as we worship God, we experience happiness. We experience a good spirit. And the text right here says, are any of you happy? Then you should sing songs. You should worship God. Now, it's easy when it's going good to get distracted by all the good things and just kind of drop praying. But when bad things happen, I've noticed people come to church more and people pray to God more and people get more concerned about where is my God. And when 9/11 happened, I was overseas on the mission field in France, but I was been told by pastors as each year goes by and we celebrate 9/11, they said, back when it happened, man, our church was full right after 9/11. When people are scared and fearful, when people have problems, then they turn to God. But what James is saying here, the key is we need to maintain a dependent reliance and focus on God in every circumstance. And that word, sing praises, in the original language, is talking about striking a chord. Some of you watched as some of our guitarists up here this morning played their instruments and they struck chords. Well, what it's talking about is the Holy Spirit striking the chords of our heart. And that's what he's talking about here. As we worship God, the Holy Spirit strums the chords of our heart and it creates in us the joy of worship. Kind of like we read in Ephesians chapter 5. Paul says, don't be drunk with wine because it'll ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves and making music to the Lord in your heart. And give thanks for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You see, when we're walking with the Lord, the Holy Spirit fills us and we experience the joy of living for the Lord. The point is, when we sing, we should sing as if our song is a prayer to God. And I don't know about you, but I love those songs that are prayers to God. Kind of like the song, I'm no good at singing, but I love that song, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. And obviously I can't sing it, but the words speak to me. And as I sing it as a prayer. And we're to pray to God, knowing that when we sing our songs as prayers to God, God can work mightily in our heart as we worship him. In Psalm 34, it says, I will always thank the Lord. I will never stop praising him. So during the bad times and during the glad times, we should turn to the Lord in prayer. But then he gives us a third category in verses 14 through 16. And he says we should pray during times of illness. If you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. God wants us to pray in times of sickness. And notice there in verse 14, he says, are any of you sick? Is anyone suffering illness here? And he says, are any of you sick? And by the way, right there, let me pause for just a moment. I forgot to mention, Christ's followers do experience trials and troubles. And we do get sick. Even though you may be a child of God, let me remind you, we don't live in a protective bubble. So what are we to do? Well, he says right here, you're to call the overseers or elders to pray for you. Now, historically, this in Southern Baptist churches has been not a separate office, but it's been seen as the pastor. Now, I know that's very controversial. There are different churches that believe and look at this differently. But in many Southern Baptist churches, they see the elders as the overseers and the pastors of the church. So he says here, you should call for the elders of the church to come and pray for you, anointing you with oil in the name of the Lord. And then in verse 15, he goes on and says, such a prayer offered in faith will heal the sick, and the Lord will make you well. And if you've committed any sins, you will be forgiven. Now, do you see there in verse 15 those words, and if? He introduces us here to a hypothetical situation. If you've committed sins, and maybe there's sickness that's resulted as a result of your sins, then you're to confess it. In verse 16, he says, confess your sins to each other so that you may be healed. Now, I want you to make it very clear. Christ followers do get sick. And why do Christians get sick? Well, I want to emphasize this because it's not uncommon to find in churches people of faith who say, I'm a Christ follower. And if you have faith, and if you're a genuine Christ follower, you will never get sick. And so if you get sick, if you have any health issues, it's a problem with your faith. You just don't have enough faith. Folks, some of these people, they claim that all Christ followers are supposed to always, 100% of the time, be healthy and wealthy. But folks, let me assure you, that is not taught in Scripture. That's twisting the meaning of Scripture to appeal to our flesh. So Christ followers do get sick. And the question is why? Well, here's the answer. Because we live in a fallen world. And I want to make something very clear. This is a doctrinal distinction. Adam and Eve, when they sinned in the Old Testament, they brought sin, sorrow, suffering, and death. So ultimately, all suffering is a result of sin. And not only did Adam bring sin into the world in sickness, but you sin and I sin. And sometimes as a result of our sin, there's sickness. But let me be real clear about something. Not every sickness is a result of sin. Did you hear that? Let me repeat it. Not every sickness is a result of sin. Jesus was walking along one day with his disciples, and his disciples saw this blind man that was blind from birth. And what did they ask? They said, Master, who sinned? They immediately just thought in their heads that all sickness was related to sin. And they said, who sinned? Did his parents sin or did he sin? Now, it's interesting because he was born blind. So how could he have sinned in his mother's womb? Well, the reality is Jews believed in prenatal sin. Woo, he's a wild one in there in the womb. He's getting crazy. I mean, well, I don't know what they were thinking, but they actually thought that you could sin in the womb. And so they were asking, you know, what's happened here? Well, you can be sick because, why? We live in a fallen world. It doesn't have to be because you've sinned necessarily. Maybe you've never committed a sin and you're still sick. Maybe someone sneezed on you and you got sick. It wasn't even your fault. I mean, I think it's clearer than ever now with COVID. You could just be walking down the street and somebody could give it to you if they had it. So Jesus said this in John 9. He said, it was not because of his sin or his parents' sin. This happened so that the power of God could be seen in him. And in Scripture, we have several illustrations of this. Job had not sinned, and yet he was sick. Paul had not sinned, and yet he had a thorn in the flesh. Timothy was instructed by Paul, do not drink water only, but take a little wine to help your digestion since you're sick so often. Now, I want to be real clear here. Some of you, you're going, boy, I'm liking this pastor better every Sunday. Last Sunday, he prescribed a nap and us to eat cake. And today, he's saying, hey, have a little wine. No, I'm not saying that. What I'm saying here is Paul told Timothy, take this for medicinal purposes. And what's interesting to me is every single wino seems to be able to memorize and quote this one scripture in the verse in the Bible. They may not know anything else in the Bible, but they can quote this one scripture here. I don't understand that. And then Epaphroditus in Philippians 2, he was sick and he almost died, but Paul never got on to him and said, hey, you man, you lack faith. No, he didn't say that at all. You see, sickness isn't a result of sin. Sickness is something that any of us can get. So Notice in this passage who James said, or what James prescribes for sick people. He says that they are to make the call. We're not to go, but they're to call. And who are they to call? They're to call the elders of the church. And what are they to do? They're to pray over them. And you need to understand that the word elders there is in the plural. And so I think there, it's good advice for there to be multiple pastors or elders or overseers praying for you so that no individual gets the credit. We always want to give the credit to God. And then why the oil? This is a mystery. Many scholars, we've studied this for years. I've read a lot of different ideas on this. But the healing, folks, is not in the oil. Are we in agreement there? The healing is not in the oil. The healing comes from God, okay? And so, what kind of oil are they using? People often ask that. I don't know. It could be Valvoline 10W40, you know? I mean, they could have stuck the dipstick in there and just flicked it on. You know, I don't know, you know? We don't know. Some will ask, well, is it Jerusalem oil? We don't know. It doesn't matter. If there's no oil, it doesn't matter. The healing is not in the oil. The oil, folks, symbolized the Holy Spirit. And it's also been interpreted to basically say, go see a doctor. Because oil was used for medicinal purposes. You know, remember the parable of the Good Samaritan? The Good Samaritan comes along and finds a man that's beaten and battered and bruised, and he's left for dead. And what does he do? He pours oil over his wounds. And so it was a very common practice to use oil for medicinal purposes. And so I believe that we need to understand that though he's telling us to pray when we're sick, faith and prayer are not incompatible with medicine and a doctor. Now, you've heard, I've heard people come and they say, I'm a Christ follower, so I don't go to the doctor and I don't take medicine. Folks, that's foolishness. God uses doctors and God uses medicine and they do their thing. But ultimately, who heals? God heals. God heals regardless whether we use medicine or God performs a miracle without medication. So we should pray faithfully. And then if we can, go to a doctor. And some say, well, I don't pray, but I go to the doctor. Well, that isn't wise either. The doctor doesn't heal you. It's God that heals you. So I would encourage you to pray and go see a doctor. And then who are we supposed to pray to? Or how, what are we supposed to pray about? Well, we're supposed to pray in the name of the Lord. And that means in the authority according to the will of God. And right there in verse 15 it says, a prayer offered in faith will heal the sick and the Lord will make them well. It's asking in faith and believing that God will heal. And I believe that God heals. And I believe he still does. And sometimes people ask me to pray for them. And sometimes I have. And sometimes they've gotten better. And sometimes I've prayed for them and they got worse. And then they say, well, I'm not going to ask you to pray for me anymore. And I'm like, you know, we need to understand that I don't control God. God does not always choose to heal. God's ways are not our ways. And God has a purpose and a plan for our lives. And sometimes he allows sickness into our lives to humble us or to teach us something or to make us dependent on him. But we need to trust him. And we need to notice that God does heal. And then verse 15, he says, a prayer offered in faith will heal the sick. And I believe that phrase, will heal the sick, really means that the Lord will make you well. But notice in the context it says, in that same verse it says, and if you have committed any sin, you will be forgiven. You see, in the context, the problem that a lot of people have is they think that he's promising to automatically heal you if you pray every single time. But in the context, it says here that if you're sick, it says, and if you've committed any sin, you will be forgiven. So the sickness could be the result of a specific sin. And if you repent of that specific sin, then God will heal you of that sin. Now, some people teach that when you're born again, if you've put your faith and trust in Christ, then healing is part and parcel of salvation. That automatically, all your sickness, all your illness is healed. That the payment was made when Jesus died on the cross for our sins. And some of them will claim Isaiah 53, and they'll say, it says he was whipped so we could be healed. But we need to go back and study that passage. And if you look at it more carefully, it says in Isaiah, when it's talking about that, it's talking about salvation. And it's a spiritual healing. And that very same passage, Isaiah 53, is quoted by Peter in the New Testament. And there he clearly says that we're healed from sin and it's for salvation. So taking Isaiah 53 and saying that it guarantees all Christians to be permanently healed is really twisting the meaning of Scripture here. If that were true, then our problem is faith. And folks, the problem isn't our faith. The problem is because we live in a fallen world, we're all eventually going to have the consequences of sin affect us. And sometimes things that we can't even imagine happen. For example, what happened to Connor? Sometimes things happen that we could maybe expect. People get old and they die. But it isn't our timing. And so we struggle with that. And if you're around more mature people, sometimes when you get around them, you can determine if they're more mature, if all they talk about is all the things that don't work in their body. I mean, it sounds like an organ recital. They go over all the different organs that week just stop working, you know. And when you're around that, you need to realize, hey, don't laugh. We're all going to die one day. In Hebrews 9, verse 27, it says, it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. So don't be fooled by those word faith teachers that say it's always God's will in every circumstance for every Christ follower to be saved. There are some great men of God in the Bible who were sick, and God used it for his purposes. If you're taking notes, you might want to write this passage down. John, 1 John 5:4. Look what it says. If you ask God for anything that agrees with what he wants, in other words, according to his will, he hears us. If we know he hears us, every time we ask him, we know that we have what we ask from him. The key is we need to ask according to God's will. And now there's another category that James brings up. And he says we need to always be ready to pray when we as individuals or as a nation turn away from God spiritually and are going through dark times. So if you're taking notes, you might want to write that down. God wants us to pray when we're going through dark times. And I want you to notice the end of verse 16. It says, the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. It says there, earnest prayer. That means a red-hot prayer that's passionate. It has great effect. It accomplishes a lot. And then it gives us an example of someone who prayed. And he gives us the example of Elijah. And Elijah, it says in verse 17, was a human as we are, and yet when he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, none fell for 3.5 years. So Elijah, James gives us the example of Elijah, and he prayed and it didn't rain for 3.5 years. And then in verse 18, it says, then when he prayed again at the end of the 3.5 years, the sky sent down rain and the earth began to yield its crops. Now, don't misinterpret this. That doesn't mean that we can pray and control the weather. I know some of you'd like to do that right now. You'd like to say to that hurricane, hey, turn away, go back out to sea. But we need to understand we can pray for the weather. But we need to understand that God is ultimately in control. And it's easy to understand, I think, because sometimes one person is praying for a beautiful sunshiny day because they want to go golfing. And then you've got someone else out there that's praying that it will rain for their garden or their grass so they don't have to go out and water it. And what has God to do with those kind of prayers? You know, rain half a day? In verse 16, it says that prayer can accomplish a lot. Prayer is powerful. And we see that in Elijah. But Elijah was a human as we are, it says here in verse 17. And what does that mean? It means that Elijah put his pants on one leg at a time, just like you and I do. And even though he prayed and fire came down from heaven, he was just an ordinary person, just like you. But the idea here is when we pray, we need to be engaged in the prayer. We've all probably heard people praying, and they were just saying words. They didn't really mean anything about it. But the scriptures tell us that we need to be engaged in our prayers. And early in the ministry of Elijah, Elijah lived during the time of Ahab. And Ahab was the wicked king of Israel. His wife was the queen, Queen Jezebel. And she and her husband had introduced the nation of Israel to idolatry and to the worship of Baal, and led the whole nation of Israel away from worshiping the one true God. And so God came to Elijah and says, Elijah, I have a message for you that I want you to go deliver to Ahab. And so he gave Elijah this message and says, give this message to the king. And in 1 Kings 17, it says this, there will be no dew or rain during the next few years until I give the word. So Elijah obeys and he goes to Ahab and he says, Ahab, because you've been such a wicked king and because you've sinned against God and because you've led the whole nation of Israel to commit adultery and to start worshiping Baal and to flee from the one true God, he said, it's not going to rain for a few years. And it's not going to rain again until I give the word. And the interesting thing is that archaeologists have found little statues of Baal with lightning rods. And what they discovered is in history that Baal was the god of the weather. So God hit them right there in their god. And it was a judgment against this god that they were worshiping. And then God told Elijah, he said, go get all the prophets of Baal and meet me at Mount Carmel. And so he went up there and he said, let's build two altars. And I'm making a long story short, but he basically said, whatever altar or whatever God answers by fire and burns up the sacrifice on the altar, that will be the one true God. And so they built two altars and all the Baal priests are chanting and ranting and raving all day long from morning till evening, trying to get their god, Baal, to answer by fire, but there is no Baal, so he wasn't there to hear them. And then finally in the evening, he goes, okay, now it's my turn. And he goes over to his altar to the one true living God. And he doesn't just call down fire, folks. He floods it with water, just totally inundates the altar with water. And then he says a little simple prayer. And God sends down a bolt of fire and just consumes the whole altar. And then Elijah tells all the nation of Israel, slay all the prophets of Baal. And then all the people turn back to God. And then he goes up higher on Mount Carmel and he prays to God. And 7 times he prays and he tells his servant after each prayer, hey, go check and see if the clouds are coming. See if the rain's coming. Because he was praying that it would rain again. And every time the servant would come back, he'd say, there's no clouds in the sky. There's nothing. Once, twice, three times, four times, five times, six times, seven times. Finally, on the seventh time, the servant probably came back and said, hey, dude. I mean, I don't know that he said, dude, okay? That's probably not in the Bible. But, you know, he probably said, hey, dude, prophet, you know, that's enough. Can't we go eat some lunch or something? I mean, you know, they're doing a special, you know, something. But nothing. He said, after the seventh time, he said, there's a little bitty speck of a cloud about the size of your hand out there in the horizon, but it's nothing. He said, now can we go get something to eat? And Elijah says, no. He says, go tell Ahab that rain is coming. What's the takeaway from this? Elijah prayed persistently. And the Bible tells us that we're to pray persistently. Jesus said in Matthew 7, keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking and the door will be open. James is encouraging us to persistently, consistently pray. And God wants you to pray. Do you know a loved one, a friend, a neighbor that doesn't know the Lord? Don't give up. Maybe a husband, a wife, a child. Don't give up. Keep praying for them. Pray for them that God will soften their heart. Pray that God will make them receptive to the plan and purpose He has for their lives. Pray consistently. Folks, our nation has never been more divided than it is right now. And the solution isn't politicians. The solution isn't political activism. The solution isn't a vaccine for the coronavirus. What is the solution? The solution is Christ's followers being salt and light and falling on their knees and praying to God. When we see violence and we see rioting, why aren't we as a people falling on our face and praying to God to heal our land, folks? Look what the Bible says. The Lord says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. Folks, God is counting on us. He's left us here until He comes. And we need to pray and witness. In your program, there's a Who's Your One little card like this. And I'd like for you to take it out and ask God to lay on your heart the name of one person that you'll pray for every day this week and that you'll invite to come this next week to our Back to Church Sunday, Friend Day. You matter to God. Every person that you encounter, every person in your circle of influence matters to God, and maybe God's put them in your circle of influence for you to impact and influence. Will you encourage them? Will you pray for them? Maybe there's people in your family that need to know the Lord or need to return to the Lord. Will you faithfully pray for them? Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your half-brother James, who gave us this book that challenges us to walk our talk, to live faithfully as men and women of faith, to pray faithfully, and to be patient even through challenging times until you come again. And Lord, I pray that if there's anyone here who's never put their faith and trust in you, I pray that today they would open their heart and life up to you and say, yes, Lord, come into my life. Forgive me of all my wrongdoing. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. Be my guide. And from this day forward, I want to follow you. If you've never invited Christ into your life, it doesn't happen by osmosis. It doesn't happen just by attending church. You personally have to make a commitment to Him and invite Him and ask forgiveness and turn from your wrong ways and follow his path. Have you done that? If you haven't, would you do it today? Maybe you're a Christ follower and you have some close friends. You might even call them your best friends. And they don't know the Lord. They're not here. They're not worshiping God today. God has put them in your circle of influence so that you can impact them for all eternity. Would you commit today to pray for them? Would you invite them to come next Sunday? Invite them to come to Bible study. Invite them to come worship with us. Invite them to our meal. Maybe you're here and you need to recommit your life to Christ. Would you do that right now? Maybe you're looking for a church home and God's led you here. Would you sign up for the next Exploring membership class and say, yeah, I want to be a part of a family of believers where I can grow and make a difference and impact this community for eternity. If God's put you in this community at this point in time, I'm certain you have a place where you reside and live. And God wants you to have a spiritual home. Would you make this your spiritual home, your spiritual family? Whatever the next step is in your spiritual journey, would you say yes to God today? Heavenly Father, do business with each and every one of us today. Help us to turn from our wrong ways and focus on you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you join me in standing and singing? As we sing, would you do business with God? Just ask him to speak to you. What is the next step you need to take in your personal life as we sing? Seated. We're going to watch just a video clip of the George Barnett offering what it goes to help support. And this week, if you would also pray for our George Barnett offerings and ask God what he would have you to give to support missions here in our state as we start new churches and new work. Let's watch this.
One day, God gave me the vision of starting a backyard Bible club in one of the oldest housing developments in Rayville. And I've been in and out of that housing development for years and knew people who lived in there and they were already dear to my heart. So it just made sense that this would be a good place to begin God's big backyard Bible club. So when we pull up, kids are just running out from all over the place. I learned early on that the children who come to God's Big Backyard Bible Club just want us. They just want our attention, and that really melts my heart. So I first got involved with God's Big Backyard a few years ago. So one of my teacher friends had told me about God's Big Backyard, and she had told me that some of our students that we taught were going every Wednesday. So I went out there to see them. The first time that I went out there, I was really surprised at how the kids were so excited to see us and to see me. They just couldn't believe that I came out on their turf to hang out with them. At God's Big Backyard, I met Wawa. Oh, Wawa, he's a force to be reckoned with. I wish everybody could meet him. At this point, I had not taught Wawa, but I knew Wawa being at my school. Everybody in the whole school knows Wawa. We built a relationship at God's Big Backyard, and I just fell in love with him. What really made my heart melt about Wawa was one day we were at God's Big Backyard and I couldn't find him. The kids had told me that he was at home having to get his siblings dressed to come out for God's Big Backyard, and at that point, he just melted my heart. I love to hear Wawa pray because it's just so honest.
But God's doing a work in his life. He told me about 2 or 3 years ago that he had received Christ as his Savior and gotten baptized.
Those kids, they just want us. They just want our attention. They just want our presence. They just want our love.
Hey, you see me today, and you love me today, and you're willing to touch me today, and you're willing to hug me today, and you're willing to meet my need today.
It's the good news of Jesus that drives us to be there for these kids.
Every prayer and every dollar counts to reach people for Jesus. We're also going to have a nomination for worship leader. So I'm going to ask the chairman of our personnel team, Brother Jubin, if he would come share about that for just a moment.
So we need to elect the pastor, the worship pastor, church committee. We have two people from the previous committee who are going to serve.
That's going to be Brenda McMorris and Les O'Neill. So we have on these slips of paper that is being passed out right now, even as we speak to members, six names. If you would choose five. So we'll have Les O'Neill, Brenda McMorris, and five people you selected. Now, the person who receives the least amount of votes will be an alternate. So after you receive one of these, if you would, just there's a box out there. You can put the slip of paper in, and someone on this side will pick it up. Where'd the pastor go? Is he gone? Oh, do you want me to pray and close, too? Is that a yes? Yes. Okay. So they're passing these out. Remember, there's six names. Mark down five. And then this will be our worship pastor search committee so we can get this going. And we can replace the wonderful work that Andre Tone was doing. And if everybody has a slip of paper, I'm going to go ahead and... Was I supposed to close this out? Okay.
We'll receive them outside the door here.
Receive them outside the door there, and then a box out front. Okay. Father, thank you for this day you've given us. Father, for this opportunity to come to your house to worship you. Father, even when things are not great, even when things in our nation and our community seems like they're going so bad, Father, you know, we can turn to you. You're our rock. You never leave us. Father, I pray for this congregation that will be the light in the community, Father, that we will do your will. And keep us all safe and healthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.